gates of heaven.
Once again.
Hallelujah. Glory. Lord, we thank you for the showers, for the rain. We need rain and revival. Oh, praise team, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, praise team. Give our praise team a hand. Oh, and our musicians, thank you, musicians. Thank you. Give our musicians a hand.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for your presence Hallelujah. In this house today. Oh, now give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Glory. It is with profound honor, great honor, to introduce this morning international speaker, Brother Ray Bell. International evangelist. Because he's going on YouTube and folks from several foreign countries will be watching him as he brings the word of
Amen.
God this morning.
Praise to Jesus.
Thank you, Brother Ray.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Bob. Oh. I would like for everybody just right now just to close your eyes. I have a song we're going to be playing, and I want you to listen to the words, okay? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That's what it's all about, folks. Amen. Not my words. Come on. Not pastor's words. No man's words. It's God's words.
Amen.
That's the only ones that count. You know, we preach and we bring to you the Word of God, and there's things that we are led to say that's from us, but it's led of the Spirit. And it should line up with the Word that God has given us. Amen. If whatever we say never lines up with the Word of God, throw it out. It's no good. I can't save nobody. I can't change nobody's mind. I can't bring anybody to Christ. I can't do that. I can do what they say, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink.
Amen.
I can do that, but I can't make you drink it. I can't make you drink it. You need an open heart, a teachable heart, to receive what's going to be preached here this morning. It's not from me. It's from the Lord Jesus Christ. So I would have you stand, if you will, while we read the scriptures in Matthew chapter 24. And we will read verses 10 through 14. The disciples had come to Jesus and asked him, what's the sign of the end of the age? Now, first thing I want to clarify to you, the world will not end. The world is never going to end. But the age of man will end.
Yes.
And that's what they were asking. When is the age? When is your second coming? When are you going to put an end to this? Of course, they didn't know anything about his second coming yet, but he had been preaching. And this is just a little bit. If you need to read the whole chapter and even chapter 25, and there's much more in Scripture about it. But Jesus said, and then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you hide me behind the cross. I'm no more than a servant to you, a slave. These are your words that we're talking about this morning. This is what you told your disciples, and now you're telling us today. Help us, Lord, to receive what you're bringing into our hearts. Help us to gain an understanding. Let the Holy Spirit lead and guide each and every one of us. And Father, may you be glorified in everything that is done in this service. In Jesus' name we ask, and everyone say it.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Well, I lost your papers, Dan.
I have a paper you can use.
269? 269 was brought in for the food bank this morning. Amen. Amen. I heard that song. Well, in our church, when we first began, we used DVDs. I worship DVDs. That's what that is off of. And I heard that song, and it just has always ministered to me, and it brings tears to my eyes whenever I hear it, because these words changed my life. I didn't know anything about these words. I didn't know anything about what Jesus said to the disciples on that day. I didn't know anything about that. I didn't even know that the disciples were concerned about such things. I just knew they were followers of Jesus. But I read a verse in Ezekiel, well, actually several verses in Ezekiel. Ezekiel 33. I'm not going to read the verses. You can go to it and read it. But I'm just going to tell you the brief meaning that it says. It says, if God brings a sword and the watchman doesn't cry out, then he will be responsible for the blood of those that are destroyed. But if he cries out and they don't take the warning, then the blood will be on them. Amen. So what you're going to get today is a warning. I have studied prophecy. I'm no theologian in prophecy, but I've studied prophecy for 40 years. I've studied the Bible for 40 years. I get into, and because when I heard a sermon, and when I hear a sermon, I make sure it's coming from God. And I go home and I study it. God has led me into that, and he's opened my eyes to several things, and this particular set of verses we've read this morning is a warning to the church. It's a warning to the church. He said in that many will be offended and will betray one another and will hate one another. Let me ask you, why don't churches get along? Why don't churches get along? Why don't we understand, you know, we're not all alike? We all don't believe the same way. You know, it says that they were in one accord in the upper room. It said they were in one accord. Does that mean that they were all thinking alike? No. What that means was they were all seeking the same thing. They were seeking that gift, the Holy Spirit. But they weren't thinking the same. They all had their own ideas. They all had their own thoughts. We all have our own ideas. We all have our own thoughts. But our thinking should be geared to the coming of Christ and the winning of souls. Now, how we do that will differ in that. But as long as we're moving in that direction, as long as we're working together, then that's the point of the whole scripture. But why do we argue? Why do we say, well, tongues aren't for today? Tongues aren't for today. Why do they say that when we know that it is? Can I be as bold to say this, that there's a denomination that believes that once you're saved, you're always saved. There's no way of you falling from the grace, falling from that. You know what? I'm not going to argue with them because I can't change their mind. Just like they're not going to change my mind about tongues. But I'm going to love them. And what's their goal? Their goal, is it to get to Jesus? Is it to get souls won? What's the goal? See, we need to put our petty little things. That's what causes hate. That's what causes hate and bickering and arguing in the church, is because you don't see it my way. You don't... I'm going to tell you, when I was first a Christian and a lot of stuff was coming to me and people didn't understand and they didn't agree with me, I got mad. Because I thought, why can't they see this? Well, they weren't me. You know, you're going to tell me things that you see and I'm going to say, praise God, knowing that I don't know where to get that. You know, but I'm not going to tell you that. As a pastor, I sit in a pew, and I hear pastor preach, I hear Brother Ken preach, I hear other sermons, and I see other ways I could go with what they're preaching. You know? And sometimes I wonder, you know, how come they don't see this? Because that isn't what God wants right then. That's not what he's looking for right then. And I had to learn. God brought me down here, took me out of a church and brought me down here and gave me 5 years to learn that my way isn't the only way. And I had to sit and listen to pastors, and I had to sit and hear things that I could have went way off in another direction that I thought would be better. But see, I have to learn that that's not me. This is the Holy Spirit. It's God working here. You're all going to hear something different today. You're all going to get something out of this message that is not going to be exactly the way I'm preaching it, or it's not going to be exactly the way the person sitting next to you is hearing it. But if you're hearing it from the Spirit of God, and it's ministering to you, and it's drawing you closer to Jesus, and it's giving you a better understanding of the Word of God, that's all that matters.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
Nothing else matters.
Right.
I don't have to be perfect in my ministry. I just have to be obedient.
Amen.
You don't have to be perfect in that pew. You just have to be obedient. And not to me, but to the Lord.
Amen.
Not to anyone in this church, but to Jesus. That's why people hate one another. Because they don't get right with Jesus. They hold on to their thoughts. They hold on to what they want. And it's going to cause division. It's coming. It's coming. Jesus said this is going to happen. And if Jesus said it's going to happen, it's going to happen.
Amen.
It's going to happen. He said many false prophets will arise and deceive many. And I'm going to tell you that word prophet there means pastors.
Yep. Amen.
Means pastors, means teachers.
Amen.
And they're going to raise up and they're going to bring a doctrine to you, to me, and to the church that is false. It might be the Word of God, but it will be twisted.
Amen.
See, I can prove anything I want to prove through the Word of God.
Without doubt.
May not be right, but I can prove it.
Amen.
I can show you where the Bible contradicts itself. But it's not really contradicting itself.
Nope.
It's just the way it's being presented.
Amen.
See, it's just the way that it's brought forward. And it makes it look like it's contradicting. You read chapters 1 and 2 of Genesis, and you will swear that the Bible is contradicting itself. Because chapter 1 takes Genesis step by step, day by day, shows the order of creation. Chapter 2 repeats creation, but it puts its emphasis on man, and it looks like everything was created before man was. But that's not it. What it is, that's called the law of reoccurrence. And what that is the Holy Spirit will give a topic and he will take it step by step and show you the order of things. And then on the next chapter, he will begin to focus in on a certain point. And that's what he did. He, in chapter 2 of Genesis, he began to focus in on man. Because how the world was created doesn't really help us much. But if we know how man fell and why man fell, and how he was the sinner, even though he was the last thing created, he was the sinner of God's plan. But see, we could argue over that. We could really argue over that, but it makes no difference. I can, 6 days. Well, is that six literal days, or is that 6,000 years? Who cares? I believe, because it says the evening and the morning was the first day. And to me, the evening and morning is exactly what I live. Sun comes up, sun goes down. 24 hours. But if it took him 6,000 years, who cares?
Right.
I don't care. He did it. I'm here. I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. I need to receive Jesus. He died for me. That's all that matters. That's all that matters. And there's going to be pastors, there's going to be teachers that are going to come up. I'm going to tell you, I could name some, and you probably could too, that have feel-good gospels. They have nothing more than a psychological preaching, and you can do it. It's all in your mind. And people, they have churches of thousands following them. See, really, what I'm even going to talk about today is the apostasy, the falling away, that which is coming. Because, see, I used to think the falling away was there was going to be a great exodus of Christians leaving the faith, leaving the church, going out back into the world. And that's not what it is at all. The great apostasy is the twisting of this word, the leaving the truth, falling away from the gospel, falling away from what God has written us, and turning it and twisting it. I want to tell you, when a pastor sits on a pulpit and drinks a beer before he gets up to preach, and that is happening, there's something wrong.
Amen.
There's something wrong. That should, you know, that church should clear themselves out of there. That church should be an empty building when he gets up to preach. Because all he's doing is he's saying it's okay to live your life the way you want to live it. I want to tell you, it's not okay to live your life the way you want to live it. It is not okay. Jesus is in charge of our lives, or he should be. Now, do I live perfectly for the Lord? I wish I could stand up here and say, yes, I do. But I don't. I don't. I get angry. I'm not supposed to get angry. I get angry. I try not to, but I'll never twist the word. I pray that God never allows me to do that, because this is what counts. An apostasy is a renunciation of a religious faith, an abandonment of previous loyalty. It's a defection. And a defection is a conscious abandonment of allegiance or duty as to a person, cause, or a doctrine. It's an abandonment of the doctrine of the Bible. This whole Bible is a doctrine. There's not just a few doctrines in here. The whole Bible is a doctrine. Everything that is in here is for us today, from Genesis 1:1 to the end of Revelation. We cannot throw any of this out. We cannot turn any of it around. We cannot change anything that is written in this Bible. Not at all. Amen. Not at all. The minute we start doing that, the minute we start causing apostasy, we start causing people to move away. I wouldn't want to be in a pastor's shoes that turns people from the Word of God, that twists it and tells the lies about it. I wouldn't want to do that. I wouldn't want to face the Lord. You know, it's a funny thing, but Paul never knew and never realized he was writing doctrine. Do you understand that? All the letters he wrote, he didn't know that it was going to be put in a book like this. He didn't realize that. He was just reading what God was laying on his heart. Every writer in this Bible, every writer in here, they didn't realize what this was going to become. They didn't realize it. People say, well, you know what? It's going to be a long time before Jesus comes. They said that for 4,000 years. And in one day, after 4,400 years, on a busy street, a busy town, because some leader wanted a census taken, and was great confusion and great stress upon the people. Everybody had to go back to their hometown. They had to get there. They had to register. It was in a mass of confusion. It was in a mass of array that Jesus came into the world, and nobody ever knew it until it was pointed out to them. Until the shepherds. Isn't it funny that God went to the shepherds first? Why didn't he go to kings? Let the kings know that the greatest king has come. Do you understand what a shepherd was in the days of Jesus? They were low life. A shepherd could see a murder. He could see who it was, and he could tell the time, the date, and everything about it, but he was not allowed to talk in court because they were liars. They were scum. They were the low life of the earth. I'm telling you, Jesus is coming.
Amen.
People say, I don't watch the news. You know why you don't watch the news? Because you don't know what the news is all about. But everything I see in the news, I see in here. Everything I see in the news, I see it, it's already been told. Mother against daughter against mother, son against father against son. Jesus said it was going to be that way.
Amen.
And guess what?
It is.
It's happening.
Amen.
It's happening. A 6-year-old child beat, I think it was a 3-week-old baby, to death. Because the mother went in to pay a bill and left him in the car, and the baby was crying. And the little boy didn't know what to do, wanted to shut the baby up. The mother's going to prison. The mother's going to prison. 19-year-old boy pledged his allegiance to ISIS and killed his neighbor. Mm-hmm. You think you're safe? Yeah. I got Jesus protecting me. I got the angels around me, but you know what? If he wants to take my life in that manner, then I'm going to be gone in that manner. Whatever he wants to do to me. You know, there's a saying, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die to get there. And that's not the point with me. I want to get to heaven, and I'm willing to die to get there, but I'd like to choose the way to die. You know, I'd like to just crawl in bed one night, pull the covers up, close my eyes, and never wake up. But that may not happen. It does happen, but it may not happen. So we're talking about a falling away. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. You can write these down. It says, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day, the talking about the end of the world, the end of age, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. The falling away, the rebellion, is going to come first. It's coming to the church, people. And there's not a church building on the face of this earth that will not be affected by that falling away, amen, by that rebellion. Amen. You may see it. You may hear it. You may want to know what's going on. But I'm going to tell you, it's coming. Amen. It's coming. When they told me I had to wear a seatbelt, I got up in front of the church. And they made it a law that I wear a seatbelt. I said, they're taking our rights away. Amen. They're taking our rights away. We should be up to, a woman can crawl up on a table and kill a baby. But I have to wear a seatbelt because they're afraid I'll get killed in an accident. Don't make any sense to me. All it is they want to take our rights away. They want control, and it's coming. It's coming. People think America is a godly nation. Well, if you think that, that's fine, but I don't think it. I don't believe it. Yeah, that's right. Not anymore. There was a day that we respected the church. There was, even in my life, when as bad as I was, I respected pastors. I respected them. I respected Christians. I never made fun of Christians. My buddy, we would come out of Walmart or Kmart. Walmart wasn't around. Kmart, and there'd be these Christians handing out pamphlets, and he'd start jumping on them and digging on them, and I wouldn't. I wouldn't. I had respect for them. We don't have that today. We don't have that today. Unless God moves miraculously, we'll never get prayer back in school.
Amen.
It will have to be a miraculous movement of God. Because this rebellion is coming.
Amen.
This rebellion is going to happen. It says that there will be a falling away first. And it says that there will be false prophets, false teachers, and people, we have them today.
Amen.
That's right.
We have them today. We have a church out in California that is sharing their pulpit with Muslims. And allowing the Muslims to preach their gospel in a Christian church. That is exactly what Jesus is talking about here.
Amen.
There's going to be false teachers, false prophets, false ministers to lead the church. And if we don't stay straight, and if we don't stay with the Lord, if we don't keep in contact with Him, we're doomed.
Amen.
Because no man can save us. No man's going to bring the word. The Holy Spirit has to bring the word. I love this church. I walked through them doors. You've heard me say it many times. I walked through them doors in January, and the Holy Spirit fell on me, and I knew this is where God wanted me. What you have to realize is just before that, I was thinking God was done with me. I was dying spiritually. I went to two churches in this little town of Greer, and I wasn't getting fed in either one of them. And I was dying. I told Judy, I'm dying. I'm dying spiritually. I believe God is finished with me. And I could not understand that, because the Bible tells me that the call is not unto repentance. He never pulls his call back.
Amen.
I walked through them doors. I had no idea what God was going to do with me. But I knew he was going to use me. I knew he was going to use me.
Glad to have you.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here and glad to have all of you. Amen. Yes. First Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Now, the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. Hey, he's not talking about somebody 2,000 years from now. Matter of fact, he was talking about somebody in his day. If it was in his day, how much closer are we to it today?
Amen.
If it was happening then, how much more will it happen now? Listen, some will depart from the faith. They won't leave the church. They won't leave the building. They won't leave the congregation. They will depart from this.
Amen.
This is the faith.
Amen.
This is the faith. The church isn't the faith. This is the faith. My faith isn't in the church, people. My faith is in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And my faith is in Jesus Christ because the Word is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
This is where my faith is at. If Judy decides not to live for Jesus, guess what? She's going to be alone, because I'm going to live for Jesus. But I know she'll never do that. I pray. Giving heed. Listen. Giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. See, we think of, when we hear that, we always think of the first church of Satan. But that's not it. It's talking about the church. The doctrines of demons are lies. The deceiving spirits are lies. They're a lying spirit that comes in. I want to tell you, I got custody of my children and brought them into the home and They were troublesome, and they were bringing some problems into the home because of the way that their mother had let them live and let them do things. And one day I was at work, and I swore it was Jesus. He said, "You need to divorce Judy." He said, "You've brought your problems into her life, and she doesn't deserve those problems, and you need to divorce her." And I thought it was God. So I went home and I told Judy, I said, "I want a divorce." I said, "It's not because I don't love you, because I do. I love you." I said, "But the Lord told me that I shouldn't have brought my children into the home and put the burden on you." She said, "That wasn't the Lord." She said, "When I married you, I married them." We sat up all night and prayed and talked and discussed. See, that was a deceiving spirit. That was a lying demon that was trying to destroy. They knew how God was going to use us. He was already using us. We had a home Bible study. That would have blown that all to pieces. But yet it sounded like God to me. It made sense. And see, that's the problem that's going to happen. It's going to make sense. What I should have really done is like what Judy and I did do. We started lining it up with the Word. Where would God ever tell? He put us together. He told me to marry her.
Amen.
Why would he tell me to divorce her? I mean, if he knew that was going to happen, he would have never said marry Judy. You know? So we need to line it up. We need to understand that the enemy is getting in. Well, he's in the church.
Amen.
He's in the church. He's the most faithful goer to church than any Christian on earth.
That's right.
I'm telling you. He's here when nobody else is here. He's just waiting for you to walk in the door. He's here. He goes before the throne of God, Satan does, and accuses us. I mean, if he can do that, he can definitely come into this building. You think he's not working right now?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, he is. Some of you, you're not going to like this. Some of you are not going to agree with it. That's okay. I'm not saying it. The Bible's saying it. Everything I'm giving you is Scripture. That's all right. 2 Timothy 3:13. But evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Those who are deceiving the church are going to grow worse. They're going to get stronger. They're going to get stronger because the worlds, the principalities and the powers of this earth are backing them. And as long as they are submitting to them, they're going to get stronger. Just like when we submit to Jesus, we get stronger.
Amen.
Just like when we turn our life over to God, we get stronger. And we need to get stronger. And how can we get strong? By the Word of God.
Amen.
We get strong. But this is going to happen. And we have to understand this. This is a warning this morning. I'm the watchman on the wall of Ezekiel, and I'm bringing the cry that the sword is coming. The sword is coming. Because God won't let it last forever.
Amen.
He's going to stop it. I don't know how far he's going to let it go. But you know what? Can I say one thing about the rapture of the church? That's right. That's my point. We don't know when it is, so we don't know how much of this we're going to see. We don't know how much we were going to have to go through as the church. See, I don't know if you have, but when I first came here, I heard of what was called the escape rapture. In other words, that there's not going to be any hard times for Christians. There's not going to be any struggles for Christians. You know, God's going to take them out. Going to take them out. I'm not going to stand up here and argue for pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib. I'm not going to argue that. I know what I believe, and you can believe what you want to believe, but I know one thing, it's coming.
Amen.
And I'm going to face some things before it gets here. I'm going to face some things that Jesus said is going to happen. I'm going to face those things, and I'm not going to be able to get away from it. I'm not going to be able to get out of it. I'm going to have to hold on to Him to get through it.
Amen.
I work at a place I can't even talk to the guys because they don't want to hear it. And I don't want to talk about what they're talking about. I don't want to hear the stuff that they're talking about. I don't care for the stuff that they're talking about. I thank God He gave me a position. I do the worst job in the plant now. I clean the water. It's stinky dirty. But I'm alone. Yes. Yes. I only see the guys when they come and want to talk to me. And when they come and want to talk to me, guess what I'm going to talk about? But they're ready for it. They're ready for it. I haven't shut myself away from them, but God has given me a place where I can tolerate being there. And I thank Him for that.
Amen.
2 Thessalonians 2:11. 2 Thessalonians 2:11. And for this reason, because of all this stuff that's going to happen, because of how these false prophets and false teachers and the deceiving spirits and the deceiving demons and all this is going to fluctuate and come into the church and grow because of this, and for this reason, God will send them a strong delusion, and they should believe the lie. God's going to do it. See, people, you don't understand. Can I give you my theory on when God said that he's going to harden Pharaoh's heart? Because I can't believe God just touched his heart and made it hard. I believe what he was saying was, Moses, when you give Pharaoh the words that I'm going to have you give him, he will become hard of heart. It was the words. It was the words. He chose not to listen. That's my theory. I find it hard to believe that God just hardened his heart. I don't believe God made Judas betray Jesus. He chose to do it. He chose to do it. I've heard people say, well, he didn't have a choice. Yes, he did. Yes. He'd be an unjust God if he made him do something that he really may not have wanted to do. See? So what he's going to do, because he knows that people's hearts are going to be hard, because he knows that these men and these women and these people will become hard-hearted and turn the word, and he'll send them a lie. He'll send them a lie. Hoping, really, he hopes that. Did you ever read in 1 Corinthians where Paul told the church there was a boy that was having a sexual relations with his stepmother? And they had approached him several times, but he wouldn't listen. Did you ever read what Paul said to do? Throw him out and hand him over to Satan. Now, do you think God really wanted Satan to take that man and take him to hell? He was hoping that you'd turn him out, hand him over to Satan, and maybe he will wise up. Maybe he will see what's going on. Maybe. Because sometimes, you know, God takes us as far down as we're going to go. Because if I could really tell you my life and tell you the things that I'll never tell nobody, you'll understand. I understand about the boy turned over to Satan.
Amen.
Because God wants that to, he'll bring these things into our lives to change us.
Amen.
He'll bring them in to turn us, to keep us, because you know why? We're stubborn.
Yes, we are.
We're stubborn. And the Bible says, you know, we're sheep and we're stupid.
Yep.
You know? When it comes to spiritual things, we are left out completely unless the Holy Spirit just brings it into our life.
Amen.
And we let him do it.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, we're doomed. So he'll let these things happen. He'll send that lie. He'll send that strong delusion. And they'll believe it, he says. And they'll believe it. Romans 1:28 says, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do these things which are not fitting. And the King James has has the words reprobate mind. And a reprobate mind is a mind that is completely absent from God.
Yes.
Never thinks of God. Cain was given a reprobate mind. He was given a reprobate mind. And God told him, because of his hardness, he gave him that reprobate mind. God will give. See, we think that God will just work with us and work with us and work with us and work with us. And that he'll do that until the end comes. So there comes a time, the Bible clearly points it out, that he will get tired of working with us. I can tell you one case when he looked down and he said, I repent that I ever made man. I'm going to wipe him from the face of the earth. But he found Noah. One man. He left them. He left one man and his family, but he destroyed everybody else. There can come a time when he says, enough is enough. And I believe I was at that point. I believe after I accepted Christ, he told me one time, this was your last chance. This was your last chance. Oh, I'm telling you, when the Lord tells you that, I am thankful.
Amen.
Because I'd have been handed over to a reprobate mind. And I don't want that. But see, that's what he says. That's what's going to happen. It's coming. Because these men and these women, their knowledge of God, they're not even concerned about it. They're not worried about it. They're not even thinking of God. All they're thinking about is, let's build this church. Let's get more members in here. Let's get more money in the plate. Let's, you know, I can have a big car. We had a pastor in Fort Wayne that he had a house. He had a big house built, and he had gold faucets. I mean, literally gold faucets. He had tile floor in his bathrooms. His house was immaculate, and he had a big congregation, brought in thousands of dollars a week, and him and his two sons, and he took up five or six offerings every Sunday, every service. He even had a loan officer in the back of the church that if you didn't have any money to give, you could go borrow the money and give to the church. And people did it. People did it. I told you, sheep. I mean, I'm going in debt to give the money to that pastor? No way. That ain't happening. Now, if this church was in straits where they needed money, and I could borrow some money to help the church get out of that, I would do it. Amen. I would do it. But I know our pastor would never really want that to happen, because he wants us all out of debt. But see, I'm telling you, this kind of stuff, this is what we're being warned about. Matthew 24, here, right here. Take heed that no one deceives you. Take heed that no one deceives you. Chapter 24, verse 4. Take heed, no one deceives you. Take heed that no one. See, it's your responsibility not to be deceived.
Amen.
It's not the pastor's responsibility. It's not the teacher's responsibility. It's your responsibility. I have to take that responsibility on myself. If I listen to the enemy, if I do what he wants to do, I can't blame anybody but me. I used to blame my life that I was living on my mom and dad. They didn't love me. They didn't care. My dad was an alcoholic. My mom called me stupid all the time. I always blamed it on that. And when I came to Jesus, I read about the prodigal son. It says when he came to himself, hey, I'm here because of me.
Amen.
That's what he said. I'm here because of me. There's people, the servants in my father's house live better than I do. Listen, everything I did because I wanted to do it. Nobody made me do it. Nobody forced me to do it. Nobody put me in a position to do it. I chose to do it.
Amen.
And now I got to choose not to be deceived. That's why I check messages out. When I hear sermons, I check them out. I love Donnie's preaching. I love Ken's. I tell you, I've been in pastors that don't preach. We was at one church. We went to church. We had a 15-minute message. We didn't know no worship, nothing. 15 minutes and it was done. He dismissed the church. My daughter, Kim, she was teaching Sunday school. She said, I didn't even get the book open, Dad. That's when we decided it was time to change churches. It was time we, ain't happening. You know, I'm going to step on some toes here. I don't care about time. And my church, they grumbled about it, but they stayed. Used to have a clock in the back of the church, and I saw this. It went down. It went down. One day I said, okay, everybody's got a watch. Let's do this. Let's take that off. Look at it. What's that watch look like? Okay. Now here, put it right here. Yeah. Because when God's done, we'll be done. Not until then. Then the kids would ask the parents, how come Pastor always yells at us? I get excited. I'm not yelling. I get excited. Matthew 24, 11 through 12. We've read it. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, and because the lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Can you imagine them losing your love? It can happen. There's not one thing that Jesus said right here that can't happen to any of us.
Amen.
We could fall into a place where we are listening to deceiving spirits. We're listening to a pastor that is not preaching the truth or is twisting the words. You say, oh man, that can never happen to me. Yes, it can. If you are not grounded in the Lord, if you're not getting with Him every day. I used to say, you know what? I would never want to leave Jesus. I would never walk away from Christ. Until our Bible study. The people in our Bible study would come and they would ask us to pray for their son or their daughter. And we would pray. They'd call me up on the phone and I would pray for their son or their daughter. Their son had run away and been gone. And then I'd get a call 5 minutes later, my son's home. I'd get calls from the parents. Our prayers have been answered. God's moving on our children. God, they're changing our... I'm praying for my children and there's nothing happening. I don't see any evidence of God working in my children's lives. I got angry with God. I said, I ain't going to church no more. I'm not going to read the Bible. But you know, God, through Judy, kept me doing the Bible study at home. I didn't want to do it. I was getting to the point I didn't want nothing to do with God. And I told Him, I hate you. I said, you are not touching my children. I'm asking and asking and asking, and I don't see any evidence of you moving in their life. And I'm finished. 2 years. 2 years I battled and struggled. Only Judy's faith and her persistence in Christ kept me online. Then I had a dream one night. And in that dream, I was in a forest, and I was about from here to them doors, and that was a clearing all out there. And the Lord says, you're almost done. You're almost finished. Hang in there. You'll be in the clearing. And the Holy Spirit began to move on me. And then God said, did you not say to me, do whatever it takes to bring your children to the throne? And I said, yes. And He said, well, what do you think I'm doing? And it was years later before they accepted Christ. But you know what? I was revived. A new faith came into me. A new faith. See, don't believe that this stuff can't happen. Don't believe that you can't fall into these traps. We have an adversary that is 1,000 times smarter or more than we are. I mean, he's been around for thousands of years. He's been around ever since man was created. He knows man more than man knows man. He knows me better than I know myself. He knows us inside and out. He knows what buttons to push. He knows what to bring against us. He knows what to do. And if we are not prepared by being in the Word of God and being with Jesus Christ, we can fall. We can fall. Now, I'm almost done. I've only got about another hour. The question then becomes, how can one protect themselves from falling into the apostasy? I didn't want to leave you on a bad note. I said, God, He gave me this first half of this message. And I said, God, I can't leave with this message. It's a depressing message. There's got to be light at the end of the tunnel, right? There's got to be some hope. I said, start showing me this hope. Start showing me this hope. How can we do it? Mark 13:33. Take heed. This is the words of Jesus. Take heed, watch and pray, for you do not know when the time is. One thing you need to do is be watching and praying. You know what it means to watch? It means to be understanding of what's going on around you. The understanding of what the Word of God says and seeing it fulfilled today on the television and the news. Because it is. So one thing we need to do is we need to watch and pray. We need to understand that God's Word is truth. He does not lie. We need to understand what He says will come about.
Amen.
And you know why it will come about? The only reason it will come about is because the whole world would have to change. And with us, that's an impossibility. I'm not saying it couldn't happen, but according to God's Word, it's not going to happen. So we need to watch and pray. We need to get an attitude of prayer. We need to build a prayer life. And we need to be watching and reading God's Word and understanding. 2 Timothy 2:15-16. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The King James says, study to show yourself approved to God. On the paper. If you just sit down and read this, that's good. But we already have preconceived ideas of things. In other words, if you read about the mountains back in the Old Testament, that they're in the mountains, the only thing I know about mountains, and the only mountains I've ever seen is the Rockies and the Smokies. So when I hear the word mountains, that's the first thing that comes to my mind. But what I don't understand is the mountains in Israel. They're not like that. See, we need to understand that what the Bible is talking about. We need to study the Word, to get into it. You say, but Pastor, how do I study? What do you mean study? How do you study? Well, one thing is you just really read in depth. You read and start marking down things that take a book and start marking down key words that are repeated through that book, key phrases that are repeated. Ask yourself, who's writing this? Who is he writing it to? Why is he writing it? And start looking for answers to those questions in the Word of God. I can guarantee you will come up with an interpretation that is true and right. It will work. Because that's how you do it. But you got to do it. It takes a diligence. It takes time. It takes a commitment to sit down and study the Word of God.
Amen.
Because we're not used to that. When God called me, He called me to have a Bible study in my home only after, May, June, July, August, September, October. 5 months after I accepted Christ. I could barely read the Bible.